as we begin to celebrate these days most holy for Christians around the world, the days of Holy Week, we begin on Palm Sunday. And here are a number of paintings, classical and contemporary, that depict Jesus' entrance into Jerusalem.
Thank you. Dear friends, welcome to this service of worship for Clairely Park Presbyterian Church. My name is Pastor Kevin Livingston, and I'm glad that you're worshiping with us on this special, special Sunday as we begin Holy Week 2021. This is one of the days that I really miss being together. This is Palm Sunday, and I have a palm frond here in my hand to remind us of what we usually do, where we sing and we wave these palm branches, recreating a bit of the atmosphere of what it must have been like when Jesus entered the city of Jerusalem so long ago. We're here to worship the Lord together today. And if you're visiting with us, or if you're new to our congregation, we're so glad that you're worshiping with us today. Hear these words of Scripture as a call to worship from Psalm 118. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Let's worship God together.
Jerusalem at last. We join the crowd streaming to the mountain. We watch Jesus approach on a lowly donkey. We hear the crowds cry, Hosanna!
Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven.
There is a joyful song in the air. The people cheer and the palms wave. But the adulation of the crowd is shallow.
Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna to the blessed of God. Son of David, save us now.
The crowd grows. The people want to be part of something important.
Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Let us pray.
God of all times, we have followed Jesus into the crowded city. We too want to catch a glimpse of Jesus. Reveal to us what true glory, leadership, and obedience look like as we now enter Holy Week. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Friends, let's lift up our hearts to the Lord and offer him our prayers of adoration and also confess our sins to him. Let's pray together. O Lord Jesus, long ago you were welcomed when you entered Jerusalem, and today we welcome you into our lives and our homes in a new and fresh way. As the children once cried Hosanna to bless you, help us to confess you openly as our Lord and Savior. As you once set your face toward death on a cross, enable us, Lord, this week to walk with you all the way to victory on Easter Sunday. Help us to experience your presence with us by the power of your Spirit, that our worship this morning and our lives this week may truly honor and glorify you. O merciful God, we admit that we are inconsistent and erratic in our faithfulness to you. Like the people who greeted Jesus as he entered Jerusalem, but soon after were crying out to crucify him, we are fickle people who often deny you with our thoughts and our words and our actions. As we remember the events of Jesus last week, help us to see ourselves for who we are, sinners in need of a Savior. Praise you, God, that Savior we have in Jesus Christ. So in honesty and in hope, hear us, Lord, as we confess our sins to you. We confess, O God, that our wills are as rebellious as Jerusalem's, that our faith is often more show than substance, that our hearts are in need of cleansing. Have mercy on us, O Son of David, Savior of our lives. Help us to lay at your feet all that we have and all that we are, trusting that you can forgive what is sinful, to heal what is broken, to welcome our praises, and to receive us as your own. Amen. Friends, hear these words from Psalm 91. Those who love me, I will deliver, says the Lord. I will protect those who know my name. When they call to me, I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them and show them my salvation. Dear friends, receive the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. And may the peace of Christ be with you. And be sure to extend that peace to someone else today with a card, with a phone call, with a text or an email, with a greeting on the sidewalk. Share the peace and the love of God with someone else this day.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord, my God, Hosanna. The highest glory.
Here now is Sharon Singh and members of her extended family as they explain to us some of the background of Holy Week and all the things that we'll be remembering in these next days.
Good morning, everyone. Today marks the last week of the Lenten season. Today is Palm Sunday. We are here in the historic city in Jerusalem where many years ago Palm Sunday started. It was said that our Lord Jesus Christ made his way through these streets on a donkey to celebrate the Passover dinner with his disciples. There were large crowds of people. Many were so excited they pulled branches off palm trees and waving, cheering, and yelling, "Hosanna! Hosanna!" as he passed by. We will now make our way to the Garden of Joseph of Arimathea. Many of us know that it is here in this garden, that life and hope began. It is here in this dark despair of the cross was replaced by life and new hope of the risen Christ. Let us sit back and hear the whole story of Easter from the symbols themselves. We have here the basin, the money bag, the chalice, the rooster, the crown of thorns, the cross, and the Easter lily. Let us begin!
This is a big bowl. There's water inside it.
I am the basin that Jesus used to wash the feet of his disciples at the Last Supper. I still remember when Peter said,
"Who is Peter?"
Peter was one of Jesus' disciples. As I was saying, I can still remember Peter saying to Jesus,
"Master, this isn't proper. I can't let you wash my feet. That's a servant's job."
Then Jesus said to Peter,
"Peter, if I do not wash your feet, you cannot be one of my disciples."
"I want to be your disciple more than anything. Okay then, you can wash my feet."
When Jesus finished washing all the feet of his disciples, he said to them,
"Sometimes you call me teacher or master. That's all right. That's what I am. But when I wash your feet, I show you that I'm also your servant. You also must be servants to one another."
Even though I'm a basin, I felt honored.
That is such a unique story.
How about this old bag?
Hey, watch your mouth.
Sorry, old bag, I mean sorry.
I'm not any old bag. I am the money bag that held the 30 pieces of silver coins that Judas was given by the chief to betray Jesus.
Wow, this is so shiny. What is this?
The chalice, the cup used at the Last Supper.
Let us break bread together on our knees. Let us break bread together on our knees.
Jesus took bread, broke it, and gave it to his disciples. "Take, eat. This is my body broken for you."
Let us drink wine together on our knees. Let us drink wine together on our knees.
Jesus said to them, "Drink, for this is my blood shed for you." Since then, I was a key symbol of the harsh treatment. Those who fall in God's way often suffer.
Boy, this is a big chicken.
I am no chicken. I'm a rooster.
Hi, rooster.
It was almost dawn. Most people were still sleeping. Something was in the air. I could hear shouting and people carrying torches. It was unusual, even for a holy day. I went near the courtyard gate. I crowed. A man stared and turned in my direction. As I looked, I saw someone approach the man and said something to him, pointing towards the palace. The man appeared angry and shouting. I crowed again. The man stopped his shouting and turned in my direction. And as I crowed once more, the man stumbled across the courtyard. And as he went past me, I could hear sobs so powerful, they shook his body.
This has thorns.
This must be the crown of thorns. Long, sharp thorns.
Yes, that's who I am. I grew on the outer wall of the courtyard of the governor. I will never forget the early hours of the morning when a man was brought before Pilate. Pilate would have released the man because he saw no fault in him. But the crowd, encouraged by the high priest, yelled, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate asked, "What has he done wrong? I find this man innocent." The crowd shouted, "Crucify him!" Someone plucked me and bent me in a spiky crown. He thrusted me on the man's head, pressing until blood flowed. Yet there was no cry of pain from the calm, quiet man.
Was that man Jesus?
Yes, Becky, that man was Jesus, our Lord.
They carved me out of wood, and they thrusted me on a man beaten and bent.
He will never be able to carry this. He could barely walk.
That our Lord Jesus Christ has risen. Amen.
Thank you very much, everyone.
After he had said this, Jesus went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethpage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.'" So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They said, "The Lord needs it." Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." He answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out." As he came near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, "If you, even you, had only recognized on this day the things that make for peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes. Indeed, the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up ramparts around you and surround you, and hem you in on every side. They will crush you to the ground, you and your children within you, and they will not leave without you one stone upon another, because you did not recognize the time of your visitation from God. Then he entered the temple and began to drive out those who were selling things there. And he said, "It is written, my house shall be a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers." Every day he was teaching in the temple. The chief priests, the scribes, and the leaders of the people kept looking for a way to kill him, but they did not find anything they could do, for all the people were spellbound by what they heard. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hosanna aloud, Hosanna, the little children sang. Through pillar, court, and temple, a joyful anthem rang. To Jesus who had held them close folded to his breast, the children sang their praises.
The title of my message today is The Tears of Jesus. The city of Jerusalem was jam-packed and crowded with visitors. Faithful Jewish pilgrims had returned from all over the Mediterranean world for the Passover feast. It was like the World Series and the Super Bowl and Caravana all rolled into one. Many of these pilgrims knew that Jesus was nearby in the village of Bethany, and his reputation as a healer, as a teacher, as a leader of God's people was growing. Some people thought he might even proclaim himself the Messiah that week and begin the process of ridding the Jewish nation of their pagan Roman occupiers so that a free, independent Israel could once again live and freely worship and serve the God of their ancestors. Earlier, Jesus had grabbed people's attention by feeding crowds of people. In one instance, a crowd of 5,000. He had cast out demons. He had healed many who were sick. He taught with such profound wisdom and spoke about God and God's coming kingdom in such intimate and encouraging ways. He'd even raised one of his friends, Lazarus, from the dead. With Jesus in town, this was going to be a Passover to remember. But you know, friends, Palm Sunday is a very strange day. It's strange because of the jumble of emotions we feel beginning today with Jesus riding joyfully and triumphantly into the city, which contrasts so strongly with what's about to happen in the days that follow. because on Monday, Jesus cleanses the temple in Jerusalem of the money changers, who said that this was meant to be God's house of prayer for all nations, but they'd turn it into a den of thieves. This violent scene provokes the Jewish leaders to intensify their efforts to get rid of Jesus. On Tuesday, he engages in a long discussion with the Jewish leaders, and he curses a fig tree for being barren, for not producing fruit. It's a clear message to the leaders of Israel. On Wednesday in Bethany, he is anointed by a woman with a very expensive perfume, almost as if his body is being anointed for burial, much to the discomfort of Judas, the one who carried the disciples' money bag for the group, who says that this was an extravagant waste of money. It could have been used to feed many other people. On Thursday, which we call Maundy Thursday, Jesus and his followers, the disciples, prepared for Passover and celebrated what would be his Last Supper with his friends. And then on that Thursday night came his betrayal, his arrest in Gethsemane, and the beginning of his trials, the trials that he faced. The crowds cried out for his crucifixion. And on Friday, what we call Good Friday, came the cross and his death. And then his body laid in the tomb. And then Saturday, in that tomb. But then on Sunday, on Easter, counter to everyone's expectation, came the unique, world-changing event of the resurrection, the day of victory, when God raised Jesus up from death, when death itself was defeated by Jesus. The Anglican preacher Fleming Rutledge tells the story of a teenage boy in her former congregation who was one of the worship assistants who carried in the cross at the beginning of the worship procession. But he turned to her before the beginning of the Palm Sunday service and he said to her, "I don't understand what I'm supposed to be feeling today." Well, you know, this young man captured very well the ambivalence we all feel about the week that's coming. People like us in churches all over the world are attracted by the joyful celebrations of a day like Palm Sunday, waving our branches and singing our praises, only to get hit over the head by the story of the crucifixion just a few days later. Some of the same people in the crowds that day in Jerusalem who were crying Hosanna and waving their palm branches were surely crying out, "Crucify him," by the end of the week. It's enough to make our heads spin. Holy Week is not for the faint of heart. You see, friends, this week more than any other, we come to the center of what the four Gospels are trying to say to us. Matthew and Mark and Luke and John all spend a huge percentage of their time giving attention to this last week of our Lord's life, to the events of Holy Week. They give more attention to the suffering and the crucifixion of Jesus more than they do for any other part of our Lord's life. And that's not by accident. From the earliest days of the church, it was understood that Jesus' life gained its significance from his death. The apostles and the evangelists wanted their readers to understand the meaning of this death more than they wanted anything else in the whole world. And that's certainly what I want all of us to understand as well, dear people of Clarely Park Presbyterian Church. When Jesus came into Jerusalem riding on that donkey, he was received with something like the sort of act claim that celebrities receive today. Jesus was mobbed, so to speak. People gathered around him, excited to be near him. The crowds pressed in around him. But his head wasn't turned by that. This acclamation didn't distract him from what he knew he had to do. He seems to have known exactly what was happening to him. And Luke's version of our Palm Sunday story, did you catch what happened just after the parade came through town? Luke tells us that as Jesus approached Jerusalem, as he saw the city, he wept over it and said, "If you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment against you and encircle you and hem you in on every side. They will dash you to the ground, you and the children within your walls. They will not leave one stone on another because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you." Jesus was lamenting for his people, for the people of Jerusalem, the judgment that was about to come. Friends, here is the purpose of our Palm Sunday worship. For each one of us and for all Christian believers to know the things that bring us peace. For each one of us and for believers everywhere to know the time of God's coming to us. And strangely enough, this peace, this time of God's coming, is precisely in the agony of Jesus on the cross. For it's in the cross that God comes fully and completely to us in the person of Jesus. It's in the cross that we find our peace. This is one of only two times in the four Gospels when it tells us that Jesus wept, that he cried. And what makes our Lord's tears here are quite extraordinary. The Gospel of Luke says, why is he weeping? He's weeping for the city. What is this city? This is God's holy city. This is Jerusalem, or at least it was supposed to be holy. But what a long, long history of disobedience and disappointment it had been. How Jerusalem had abandoned her holy calling. For 1,000 years, God had been preparing this city, Jerusalem, through the prophets to meet her Messiah, her Savior, her Redeemer. And at last now, as the Messiah appears, what do the people of the city end up doing? This city is going to arrest Jesus on a trumped-up charge and then try him in the middle of the night and flog him nearly to death and execute him the way we execute serial killers and terrorist bombers, though in an infinitely worse manner on the cross. Jesus weeps for the city. He weeps for all those who will soon shout, "Crucify him." In other words, Jesus weeps for us. Has anyone ever wept or cried for you? Did your mother shed tears because you did something that disappointed her? Did your father weep for you because you got into some kind of trouble? Or did a daughter weep because her father abused her? Did a son weep because his father blamed him for something that he had never done? Have you ever wept for a friend lost or taken early in their life because of an accident or illness? Do you ever weep for a young person kicked out of their home, or people living on the streets living rough because of their mental health condition? Did you weep for the victims of some tragic, hideous injustice like that shooting in Colorado last week? People are very rightly grieving for those 10 victims in Boulder, Colorado. But what about that young man who committed that horrific crime? Is anybody weeping for him? All these tears, and every tear that's ever been shed by anyone, anywhere, are rolled up into the tears of Jesus. Jesus weeps for the city of Jerusalem. Jesus weeps for this world in its sinfulness and in its sinned againstness. Jesus weeps for all the pain that we have suffered and all the pain that we've caused others. The Son of God weeps for you and for me. A while ago, there was a 60 Minutes program on television about a terrible massacre that occurred in Algeria in North Africa. The correspondent, Christian Amanpour, was interviewing a man who watched these troops come in and murder his whole family, his wife, and his children. He showed Christian the locations, the bloodstains, the place where he hid and watched, unable to do anything to save them. He described all of this in a dispassionate tone, like he was a journalist or a tour guide, so that we, the television audience, wondered why he didn't seem to feel anything. Maybe he was in shock. But after he finished his description, the camera left him and went on to show a few other things. But a few minutes later, the camera returned to show him sitting at a small table with his head bowed. And as the camera moved in, the camera revealed that he'd been silently weeping. The tears fell down his face and dropped onto the table. No words were necessary. In those silent tears, there was a whole world of inconsolable sorrow. You know, tears don't make any noise, but they're eloquent. Tears speak. They say that judges sometimes look for tears when they're looking for a reason to give a lighter sentence to a convicted criminal. Jesus's tears encompass the entire human tragedy. He weeps for that Algerian man and his family, and also for the killers of this man's family. In the tears of this one man, Jesus, God's complete solidarity with human pain, yes, but also with human sin, is shown. That's what the tears of Jesus show us. And yet, friends, we are all like the people of Jerusalem. How easy it is for us to fail to recognize the time of God's coming. We don't want a crucified Messiah, and one way or another, we want to make Easter come easier. Why is it that we don't like the cross? Why can't we just skip the messy events of this week, brush right past Good Friday, and come back to church on Easter Sunday when everything is beautiful and hopeful and joyous and victorious? Well, there are lots of reasons. But as one preacher puts it, one of the big reasons we should never skip over Good Friday and the cross is because it helps us come to terms with the fact that it was good religious people, people a lot like me and you perhaps, who are responsible for our Lord being there on the cross on that dark day. In some churches on Palm Sunday, they read the whole story of Jesus' death from one of the Gospels, long scripture readings from Matthew or Mark or Luke. And the whole congregation plays the part of the crowd in the story, shouting out loud, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" It's hard to say that, isn't it? But if we can't say that, then we really don't yet understand that the cross is what brings us peace. Otherwise, the real mystery, the real meaning of the mystery and the suffering of these events is hidden from our eyes too. Some of us don't see that Jesus weeps for each and every one of us as well. He's not just weeping for Jerusalem or for the whole world. He's weeping for you and for me. But if we don't want to see that, if we can't see that, then we miss the whole point and we miss the possibility of being remade from the inside out by the amazing grace of God. Easter wasn't made easy for Jesus. The book of Lamentations, chapter 1 says, "Look and see if there is any sorrow like his sorrow." Easter cost the greatest price that has ever been paid in the history of the universe. And yet, miracle of miracles, for us, Easter is free. It cost us nothing. It cost God everything. We didn't deserve God's ultimate sacrifice, but God paid it out of the vast storehouse of his unconditional love. Your tears and mine are always a mixture of deep feelings to be sure, but also sentimentality. But the tears of Jesus spring from God's innermost heart of yearning compassion. They spring from God's boundless love. The Messiah weeps for the sin that brings him to Jerusalem to die for that city's redemption and the redemption of the whole world. You see, friends, it's our sin that brings Jesus there, and it's our sin that he carries away from us like the scapegoat going out into the wilderness. He weeps for you and for me. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each one of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all, as the prophet Isaiah puts it. Dear people of God, as the Apostle John says in the book of Revelation, "I have seen your faith. I have seen your love for one another." And it's because I've seen your faith and your love in action that I'm confident that you, as a congregation, that you don't want to miss recognizing the time of God's coming to you this week. As you worship and as you pray, and as you ponder over these next few days, know that these events that we commemorate this week are what brings us peace. Peace is found not in escape, not in denial, not in some false hope, but only in the cross. Friends, what load are you carrying? Bring it to Jesus. He's already taken and carried it. What secret tears are you bottling up inside? Jesus already knows, and he understands. He is taking it with him as he begins his journey to the cross. As the great hymn writer put it, "Man of sorrows, what a name, for the Son of God who came, ruined sinners to reclaim. Hallelujah, what a Savior." Amen. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, Savior of the world, though easier paths surely beckoned you, and your friends pleaded with you to remain with them, you turned your face resolutely toward Jerusalem, determined to go all the way to the cross of Calvary for our sake. Take us with you now, Lord, and show us how through your sufferings and your tears, you conquered evil and you saved our world. We worship and adore you this day. Amen. Friends, let's lift up our hearts to the Lord. O God, as we enter into Holy Week, help us to remember the long and lonely journey to the cross that Jesus walked. Gather us close to you in these next few days as again we make this journey in our thoughts and our prayers. Help us to remember and think about the way that our Savior Jesus walked, the false charges hurled against him, the fear of the disciples and the way they abandoned him, the kiss of betrayal, the crown of thorns, the purple robe. And as we remember and think about these things, give us courage to face those times in our own lives when we've treated you this way. Yet help us also remember that you have gone before us, so we look to you for compassion and for forgiveness, knowing, Lord, that you are able and willing to save us because of your amazing grace. When we are weak, make us strong. When we are sick, pour out your healing. When we are hurt or resentful, make us forgiving. When we are defeated and discouraged, make us hopeful. Keep us from asking for mercy without giving mercy to others, or from praying for your kingdom's coming but never working for it. Lord, hear us today as we pray for those in need of your healing touch and our church family and our extended loved ones as well. For Fred Clark and Denora Herman. For Fred Cooling and Patrick Chung. For Karen McDowell. And for Rebecca and Hanukkah and Holden and Lucy, and for other friends and loved ones whom we name before you now. Lord, in this week, deepen our faith through your matchless grace. Deepen the measure of our gratitude and obedience. Lead us, O God, in the way of Christ. Give us courage to take up our cross and in full reliance upon your grace to follow him. Help us to love you above all else and to love our neighbors as we love ourselves, demonstrating that love with our actions and our words, in the power of your Holy Spirit. Give us grace, Lord, to serve you faithfully until the promised day of resurrection, when with your saints and your redeemed ones of all the ages, we will feast with you at your table in glory. And now, friends, let's pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Dear friends, as we finish our worship service today, hear the words of Jesus who said, If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. May our Lord Jesus, whose arms were spread wide on the cross, wide enough to embrace the whole world, help us this week to take up our cross and follow him. And now, friends, receive the blessing. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit remain with you now and always. Amen.
happy birthday.
Birthday.